their lives from oppression and violence, and dear shall their blood be in his sight. Long may he live, unto him may be given gold from Sheba. May prayer be made for him continually, and may they bless him all the day long. May there be abundance of grain on the earth, standing thick upon the hilltops. May its fruit flourish like Lebanon, and its grain grow like the grass of the field. May his name remain forever, and be established as long as the sun endures. May all nations be blessed in him, and call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wonderful things, and blessed be his glorious name forever. May all the earth be filled with his glory. Amen. Amen. My Bible knowledge is letting me down now. I think that was written for the coronation of King Saul, or maybe King David, but certainly appropriate for the coronation of our king as well. I hummed and hawed about postponing communion from our normal first Sunday of the month to next week because of this special service today, but they had communion at Westminster Abbey yesterday, so I thought it was appropriate for us to include it in our service. So I'm going to ask you to stand now, as you normally do during Holy Communion, for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Hear the Gospel of our Saviour Christ, according to St. Luke chapter 22, beginning at verse 24. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. A dispute also arose among the disciples as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentile lords it over you, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and a leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred to me, our kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Some people think our next hymn really shouldn't be sung too often in church because it doesn't talk about God or reference Jesus at all, but the two verses are what we have loyalty to our country, and of course loyalty to the other country whose king we don't see, and that's God's kingdom. So let's sing the hymn, "I Vow to Thee, My Country." there's a short creed in the order of service on page 4, which we'll say together now. We believe. We believe in God the Father, who made the world. We believe in Jesus Christ, his Son, who redeemed humankind. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. Please do take your seats. So I'll try to remember what the Archbishop prayed before the start of his sermon yesterday and pray that short prayer now. Holy Spirit, fill our hearts with the flame of your everlasting love. Amen. So last September, I remember putting together a special commemoration service for the first Sunday after Queen Elizabeth's death. She died on the Thursday afternoon, you may remember, so this was just 2 or 3 days later. On that same Thursday, I had started preparing my sermon and had chosen the appointed gospel reading to preach on, which was the parable of the lost sheep and coin. Indeed, I got most of the way through writing it when I sensed it probably wasn't the right thing to preach it. I sensed that it was a momentous occasion on that Thursday when the Queen died, the 8th of September, I think. I sensed that we'd lived through and experienced the longest reign in history, that the Queen had summed up and epitomized everything that was good and healthy about our country and everything that was good about a monarch and what we would want and desire in a monarch. The Archbishop of Canterbury said the Queen had gifted us the hope we have in our country, in God, in eternal life, because of her life of service, faith, and commitment. So I quickly ditched the sermon I'd prepared and wrote a very different address as part of a service which shone a light on the Queen's service, commitment, and undoubted strong Christian faith. I included extracts from some of her speeches and broadcasts, and I encouraged people to give thanks for her life and for the witness of our Queen and applaud her example of faith and self-giving, through which we all could see and know the fullness of God's power and glory. Maybe it was only on her death, maybe not, but perhaps it was only on her death and through our reflection after it that we recognize the incredible faith of Queen Elizabeth, probably the greatest Christian monarch in known history. I know that's a big claim, but I believe there's plenty of evidence to substantiate it. I wonder, do we feel confident that our newly crowned king has an equally strong Christian faith, which is an example to us? Or do we perhaps have a few more questions about Charles III? Do we have any cause to worry about him, to worry that the headship of the Church of England, the most important branch of our Anglican Church, do we have any cause to worry that the headship of that church is in his hands? Possibly concerns about King Charles come from the marital difficulties he experienced and the popularity of Princess Diana, and maybe also his openness to other faiths, while at the same time he is arguably less forthright about his own Christian faith than his own mother was. I don't think there's much evidence to suggest we have anything to worry about. In fact, to the contrary, the criticism of him seems a little unfair. He has shown commitment to the Church of England. He is a regular worshipper with a serious interest in Christianity and its theology, which would put some of our own complacency and lack of studious endeavour into faith matters to shame. He loves the Anglican liturgy and is committed to spiritual matters. Prayer very clearly has deep meaning for him. Just witness the King's own prayer from the service yesterday, which we will use later in our own service, and witness his response to the young Chapel Royal chorister who welcomed him at the start of the ceremony. I don't know if you remember that young boy coming forward. King Charles said this in response: "In his name and after his example, I come not to be served, but to serve." He was saying, in the name of Jesus and following the example of Jesus, he wants to serve with the same sense of duty and following the example of Jesus, the same sense of duty that his mother had. In fact, yesterday's service had as its theme called to serve. And this continued to be seen not only in this prayer, and possibly the first time a prayer like that was said in our history, such a personal prayer voiced so publicly by the sovereign, not only in that, but throughout the whole of the service. Any worry that King Charles is soft on Christianity and likely to promote other faiths, perhaps because of their prominent part yesterday, and his comments on the importance of interfaith relations, any worry about that, I believe, is misguided. He definitely has a serious interest in and is open to other faiths, driven more by his acknowledgement that the reality of our society is that it is diverse, it's multi-faith and not solely Christian, driven by that more than by him turning away from Christianity. Instead, he is living what Jesus modeled, that we should love all our neighbors, whatever their beliefs, or even if they've no beliefs, and be inclusive of everyone. Moreover, I think you saw for yourselves yesterday that there was absolutely no compromise with Christian beliefs. The ceremony was in a Christian abbey, led by Christian leaders, with Christian beliefs, symbolism, and values at its core. The bits and pieces of the occasion, all the elements of the service, were explicitly Christian. In the oath Charles swore, he promised to God and to us all to govern faithfully, with justice and mercy. He promised to maintain the laws of God and the true profession of the gospel. That is the true profession of the good news of Jesus. And just before he promised those things, he was presented with a Bible, the most valuable thing that this world affords, the most valuable gift ever, as the moderator of the Church of Scotland said when he presented it. I think it was possibly the most Christian of all public royal family services, which of course, as we will today and as I've referenced already, included Holy Communion, the coming together in common union as followers of Jesus, remembering his love and sacrifice, and worshipping his divinity. As well as the coronation having God central to the whole event, it also had the nature of priesthood and anointing running through it. I thought the most emotional part, certainly for me, and one that just made me nearly well up, was that time when the covers came round and hid him off from the rest of the congregation when he was anointed on his hands and his feet and his chest by the Archbishop. We witnessed that the king's role just then is made sacred in that most holy part of the service, which echoes what has happened at coronations all the way back to King David. Anointing emphasizes the spiritual role of the sovereign. It's more to do with the king being anointed so he can serve the servants of God rather than the divine right of kings being conferred on him. It's a divine duty, not a right that he has to serve. And in this, we see what Jesus talked about, that he came in that Luke reading we heard, that he came to serve, not to be served. We see so clearly this Christian thought that the greatest person, the grandest person, the most important person is and should be the greatest servant who serves. There's no doubt a lot of Christianity is hard. I talked a few weeks back about one difficult aspect for us all, forgiveness. There are loads more, but maybe this one is up there as one of the hardest, if not the hardest. If we are to follow Jesus, we ought to be people who seek to serve others, no matter what position we hold or how important our role is. Jesus, God, he wrapped a towel around his waist and washed feet. Jesus, God, the most perfect, the most innocent, sacrificed himself in an act of service. In so doing, he showed the truth of the matter, that the greatest is not the one being served at the table, but the one who serves. So no, I don't think we have any cause to worry about King Charles. I'm sure he will endeavor with all he has and all he is to serve us and his country, and most importantly, to serve God. I hope and pray that this wonderful church family here in Ballymore can be inspired by that and always remember that our calling is to be servants of each other, of King, of community, of country, and of Jesus. That is how we will become great in God's eyes. And just the first verse from him, which is not printed in the order of service, which is nearly a prayer. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. Amen. So I'm not sure if the young members of the congregation are joining us right now, but they're coming in very shortly as we sing our next hymn, which of course was sung also yesterday at the coronation. And let's stand to sing Christ is Made the Sure Foundation.
Thank you.
Please do sit down, everyone. Your timing's very good. I was thinking I might have to pray the prayers, but so Mary and Mark, you come forward and get yourself ready at the lectern. I'll maybe just have a quick word with the young folk who've come in before you pray for us. So boys and girls, what have you been doing over in the hall at A&S Club? Now you don't all have to answer at once. What have you been thinking about?
Kings.
Kings, okay. Any kings in particular?
All
types of kings in the Bible. And do you learn about loads of different kings? Can anyone else, I don't want to pick on you all the time, can anyone else tell me some of the kings? Anna, you tell me some of the kings you were learning about.
King Solomon.
King Solomon. What was King Solomon known for? Being wise. Now, he maybe wasn't that wise because he had 300 wives. One's bad enough. But yes, King Solomon's known for, I think he had 700 girlfriends as well, did he? Who else? Any other kings you were thinking about? Which one?
King Asa.
King Asa, very good. King Asa, maybe, I don't know how it's pronounced. Asa's probably the right way of pronouncing it. What's King Asa known for?
King.
He was a good king, yeah. Some of them are just a bunch of wasters. In fact, if you read the Book of Kings, you'll see most of them are a bunch of wasters. They turned away from God, but King Asa, King Asa's known for praying to God when he was sick as well. Sometimes we forget that, so there's a good lesson there. Any other kings you were thinking about? I'm sure you're talking about King Charles. What did you learn about King Charles? Were you talking about King Charles? No? Anyone want to say? Go ahead. Good boy. Pardon?
King Ahab.
King Ahab, there's another one from the Old Testament. Very good, very good. Okay, we were talking at church about King Charles and how in the service yesterday, he was basically saying he wants to be a servant to everyone, even though he's the top man in the whole of the kingdom. His role is to serve us all, and so there's a lesson for us all in what King Charles did. So I'm going to pass over. I'm not sure how you're doing this, but the prayers are printed in the order of service, so you might like to follow as Mary and Mark lead us in prayer. So let us pray. Page 5 in the order of service.
Lord God, in your power you provide for your people and rule over them in love. Grant to your servant Charles the spirit of wisdom and government, that being devoted to you with his whole heart, he may wisely govern. During his reign, may your church be protected and Christian devotion continue in peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
O God, bless all members of the Commonwealth of Nations, bound together under one King. Help us always to take seriously our great responsibilities, to foster in every place the peace and goodwill which gives you alone the glory.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, hear our prayer and multiply your blessings upon your servant Queen Camilla as she offers herself with humble devotion to your service. Defend her from all danger, make her an example of virtue and godliness, and a blessing to the King and to his people. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
King of kings and Lord of lords, fill the hearts of all in authority in every land in the world with the love of your laws. And with all that is righteous and life-giving, we especially pray for leaders of countries in turmoil and the poor, asking that they may be wise and worthy stewards of your gift, and rule with fairness and justice to all. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. During the singing of the next hymn, Before the Throne of God Above, the offertory will be taken. Our service continues on page 216 in the prayer book, page 216. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
If you like, you can sit at this point or kneel, or you can stay standing, whatever you're comfortable with. Father, Lord of all creation, we praise you for your goodness and for your love. When we turned away, you did not reject us. You came to meet us in your Son, welcomed us as your children, and prepared a table where we might feast with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened wide his arms upon the cross, and with love stronger than death, he made the perfect sacrifice for sin. Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, on the night before you died, you came to table with your friends. Taking bread, you gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, we bless you. You are the bread of life. At the end of supper, you took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, we bless you. You are the true vine. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Holy Spirit, giver of life, come upon us now. May this bread and wine be to us the body and blood of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us who know our need of grace, one in Christ our risen Lord. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, blessed Trinity, with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of thanks and praise, and lift our voice to join the song of heaven, forever praising you and singing. Thanks be to you, our God, for your gift beyond words. Amen, amen, amen. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. We being many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. When you come to the rails to receive communion, you can either receive just the bread or bread and wine together. If you only would like to receive bread, then just leave the rails after you have received the sacrament of the body. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Remember that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith with thanksgiving. Eternal God, in word and sacrament, we proclaim your truth in Jesus Christ and share his life. In his strength, may we ever walk in his way, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So we're singing again now from the order of service, page 6, a hymn which I understand is maybe King Charles' favorite, maybe one of his favorites, and there was an adaptation of this hymn heard before the service yesterday, hymn 643, Be Thou My Vision. It'd be good if you could remain standing for the rest of the service. If it's a bit too long for you, then please do sit down. We turn to the act of dedication on page 6 below the hymn there. So as we give thanks for His Majesty's coronation and anointing and His commitment to service to us all, let us dedicate our own lives once again to the love and service of God and neighbour. Lord of our lives and Father of all, grant that our thanksgiving may prove itself in service to you and to the King, our country, and one another. For your name's sake, amen. And we pray together a slight variation of the King's own prayer, which he prayed yesterday. God of compassion, God of compassion and mercy, whose Son was sent not to be served, but to serve, Give grace that we may find in your service perfect freedom, and in that freedom, knowledge of your truth. Grant that we may be a blessing to everyone, that together we may discover the ways of gentleness and be led into the paths of peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
God save us.
With the joy of Christ in our hearts. Help us, Lord, to share your joy. We leave with the peace of God in our hearts. Help us, Lord, to share your peace. We leave with the Spirit's strength in our hearts. Help us, Lord, to share your love. Christ, our King, make you faithful and strong to do his will, that you may reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. So just before we conclude with the hymn on the back of the order of service, I want to bring your attention to some of the notices. I think you all should have a printed sheet today, so I won't go on too long, but this Wednesday there's a Mother's Union service at 7:30 in Armagh Cathedral. With members of the Mother's Union who are going, please meet in the car park at 6:50. The Bible discussion and prayer group will recommence after the Easter break this Thursday at 7:30 in the parish room. Everybody is welcome. Please don't feel under pressure if you come to that. Come along, just enjoy it, and you don't have to do anything but just take in and soak in what we're talking and thinking about. Christian Aid Week is from the 14th to the 20th of May. This is a very important fundraising event for Christian Aid because it gives them non-earmarked funds, i.e. funds that they can use for just dealing with poverty and issues around the world at any time, as opposed to what you may have given, say, in February after the earthquake, which is specifically earmarked for that. So we're pleased to support the Christian Aid Week by having envelopes in the pews for the next two Sundays. And if you'd like to support the work of Christian Aid, please just put your envelope on the plate with your usual offering. Big day in a couple of weeks' time, S Club prize giving. Please, please make a special effort to be here to support the younger members of our congregation on that day. I'll say the same next week. It would be lovely to see the church full for that day. And a note for the diary, 18th of June, the rededication of the church building with the Archbishop of Armagh, who was obviously important yesterday and played a prominent role in the presentation of the orb with the cross on the top of it. Black bag collection by the end of May, please. And afterwards, you're all invited to stay behind for a bring your own picnic. If you want to stay, and you haven't brought your own, don't worry about it. We'll get some grub for you. Please do stay. Don't rush off just if you haven't brought anything with you. There'll be something that we'll find for you. Maybe a bit of moldy old bread and a stale old digestive biscuit, but you'll get something, so please do stay behind. I'm just going to say grace now so that you can move over to the hall. And the hall's looking absolutely tremendous. Thanks to all those who turned up on Friday night to see the hall prepared for today's gathering. So, Father, we do thank you for the coronation of our King, and we thank you for this time together and the time we'll share afterwards celebrating as well. And we give you thanks for the food and for the time and the spirit we will spend in the hall. Bless the food to our use, and as we do so, we give our thoughts to all those who go without. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So please continue singing as well as you have done so far, O Christ the Same, through all our stories pages. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.